As we start out this short little tour of what's left in Burke, I wanted to mention that over this town's lifespan, more than one business, mine, or building may have been located at the same spot. I may point out a place and say it was such and such, while someone else may point to the very same location and say it was something else, and we would both be right. And the same goes for mines that often change names when they were bought out by a different company, and or claims that changed hands. From the historic marker sign, you can see there really isn't much left of Burke. Traveling up the road a short ways to mile 6.5, and on your right, are the stairs and foundation of the Burke United Methodist Church. And just to the right of this was the Burke Public Swimming Pool, which has since been filled in. The swimming pool was a favorite place in the summer for not only the kids who lived in Burke, but also those who lived along Canyon Creek. There were once a row of changing rooms, and it even had a diving board. Along the hillside behind this area, you can still see a few houses that are behind the trees. These are located on a road that's called Shifter's Hill. It was so named because at one time, all the mine shift bosses had their homes located here. Access to Shifter's Hill is just a little further up the road. Continuing a bit further up the road, you'll see the tailing piles on your left. There was once a couple of different mines here and up on the hillside. The Sherman Mine, also known as the Leary Mine, and the Anchor. Just below in this area was once several buildings, including the Burke Catholic Church. Up above, there was once several homes and other structures, and this was one of the more avalanche-prone areas in Burke. Though avalanches were fairly common all along the canyon, one of the worst happened on February 4th, 1890. A story in the Spokane newspaper the next day gives us a pretty good account of what happened.
On the afternoon of February 4th, 1890, the mountain unleashed on Burke. An avalanche of snow, rocks, and timber thundered down the steep slopes, burying much of the town. Half of the business houses are in ruins. Three men were killed, and terror-stricken inhabitants have fled to the towns of Jim and Wallace, fearing a repeat of the disaster. When the avalanche broke loose, a blinding mist and roar warned the family of the miners below of its approach. Surface trains were crushed and twisted, and cabins ground as eggshells by the grinding mass of trees, stumps, and earth and boulders to a depth between 50 to 70 feet. Its track down the mountainside was swept as clean as a floor, and the deafening roar was heard for miles up and down the canyon.
Of course, the most visible structure in Burke is the Hecla Sorting Plant and Compound. There are actually two mines here, the Hecla and the Star. Hecla is on the south end while the Star is on the north. The compound that makes up the Hecla Star is about the only thing that reminds one that Burke was once home to a very large mining operation. These structures that you see now were built between 1923 and 1925 after a large fire destroyed the original wooden ones. As the fire raced towards Burke from the Mace area, the hoist operator stayed at his position trying to get as many of the miners up from the mine as he could. As the men were being hoisted up, the cable itself caught on fire, putting itself out as it wound around the drum. Eventually, the entire hoist shack caught on fire and the operator had to flee for his life. The miners who were left below were able to eventually climb their way out. Both Hecla and the town of Burke began to rebuild immediately. The fire was kind of a blessing for Hecla, as they were able to build a new and modern facility that greatly helped improve their production. Just across the road from the Hecla building is the beginning of the Burke Business District. The concrete along the side was the back wall area of the Burke Hotel. The abandoned house that now sits on the right of it was once the home of the Lemnixes. They owned a grocery store that was located just a couple of doors up. And though there's nothing of the grocery store left today, back in 2005, the brick shell of the building was still standing. Next to the house was the combination bar. It was both a bar and a barber shop. Gone also is Vic's Tavern, the Tunnel Bar, and Lantern's Clothing Store. The one building still standing that looks like a garage, I believe was once the Burke Drug Store. I'm kind of guessing on this as I arrived to this conclusion by counting the foundations and trying to compare that with old photographs. Just across the road, you'll note the footbridge that leads over the creek to the Hecla Star compound. Well, it was right in front of this that the Burke Railroad Depot is located. Going up a bit further on the left is what remains of the business district's buildings. These buildings have housed several different businesses over Burke's lifespan, including Cook's Grocery Store, Morrow's, the Burke Post Office, a supply store, and a service station were all here at one time. Across the road, you'll note a concrete wall, and just to the right side of this, there at one time was a large wooden building that served as Burke's Theater and Union Hall. There was a doctor and dentist that had offices on the second floor. I bring this up as a point of interest because at the grand opening of the theater, one of the opening acts was a 4-year-old little girl by the name of Julie Jean Mildred Frances Turner, who performed a tap dance routine for the audience. The following year, they had moved to Wallace, and years later, she moved to California, where she became discovered as a teenager, and she changed her name and became known around the world as Hollywood's iconic leading actress, Lana Turner. Also on this side was the Star Mine. The Star Mine was the last big operation that was left in Burke, but closed down in 1981. At the time of its closing, the Star had the distinction of being the deepest mine in North America at 8,100 feet. That's equivalent to 5.5 Empire State Buildings stacked one on top another. At about mile 7 on your left was the location of the Tiger Mine. Up on the hillside was the location of the original discovery, and before closing, the Tiger had reached a depth of 1,800 feet. The Tiger Poor Man Mill sat at this open location. On your right sits a wigwam from the Hecla Star Sawmill that once was located here, and there was another sawmill just a little further up the road. The open area above the wigwam was the location of the Tiger Hotel. It was this building, more than anything else, that got Burke mentioned in Ripley's Believe It or Not column twice. Built in the fall of 1887 by S.S. Glidden, it was not really a hotel in what we think of today. It was a boarding house built to house the single miners and mill workers. It was 3 stories and had 150 rooms. By 1915, Burke had grown to the point that the Tiger Hotel needed to enlarge. An addition was built that housed the lobby, the kitchen, and the dining area. And as with many other cookhouses, this was referred to as the Beanery. But what really put the Tiger Hotel on the map was the fact that it was the only hotel in the world that had a road, a railroad, and a creek that ran through the lobby. As stated earlier, space was very limited in Burke. By the early 1950s, the Tiger no longer served a real need. The first part to be torn down was the new addition, known as the Beanery. And in 1954, the rest of the hotel was demolished. Some of the foundations can still be seen along here. It's all that's left of a truly unique hotel. Up a bit further at mile 7.2 is Gorge Gulch. The cribbing and rock along the hillside are from the Hercules mine that was located up the gulch a short way. The gulch at one time was lined with buildings and mine workings. Entire books have been written about the Hercules mine and some of its owners, so I'm not going to take the time to go into their story, other than to say that the Hercules mine is a true success story. Over its lifespan, the Hercules mine produced over 30 million ounces of silver and several hundred thousand tons of lead and zinc. The buildings that once were located on the hill at the gulch are long gone. The brick building was once the offices of the Hercules mine, and I was told that this building was also the Burke Fire Hall, though a couple of others I know believe the fire hall was a separate building that sat next to it. From here on up the road begins what is often called Upper Burke. This is mainly the residential section. At mile 7.3 on the right, though obscured by the trees and brush, is the foundation of the Burke Public School. The week I had to go film last summer just happened to also be the week Avista Power was working in the area, so I wasn't able to get any good footage. All I have is some old standard quality VHS and a few photographs. The gulch and hillside to the side of the school was once the location of the marsh mine. Across the road and on your left, you can still see the stairs and a few foundations of the houses and buildings that once stood along the hillside. At about mile 7.5 on the right is the waste rock dump of the Gurdy mine. There's also still a few homes left along this side that are summer homes for a few people. Across from these houses is a foundation of what was once a two-story rooming house. According to local lore, the upstairs was the home of Lana Turner when she was an infant and before they moved to Wallace. Traveling up the road, there's really nothing left to see. And at the very end of the road, at about mile 8.4, is the old Montana Power Plant. The area around the Montana Power Plant was also the location of the Burke Ski Area, though the hillsides have long since been reclaimed by the forest. Burke was one of the first ski locations in the state of Idaho that had a lighted slope for night skiing. Off to the left and back down what is now a dirt trail was the location of Hearn's baseball field. At one time, baseball was still America's favorite sport, and almost all the bigger mining operations in the Silver Valley had teams. Every town had one, too. The Hecla Star Mine team from Burke became the Idaho State Champions in 1949. Going through some old newspapers from the 40s and 50s, I noted that there were several games that were called because of darkness, and I thought it odd since the power station and the lighted ski area was only a few hundred yards away. I also noted several games were delayed from time to time due to deer wandering into the playing field, wondering what all the commotion was. There is no doubt that Burke was a unique mining town. Though there really isn't all that much left, it's still well worth a look. Being only a few miles off Interstate 90, if you find yourself traveling through, I encourage you to take a look for yourself. Thanks for watching. Sorry about the poor quality of the video, and the audio, and the narration, and the editing. Hopefully I'll be able to get some new equipment someday, and a new narrator. And I'll try to do better next time.